To really say about that is I have two things to say about that, Mr. Fred. One thing is that has to be the most proven simplistic bass lines that nobody else probably in the world could have come up with but you, number one. And number two, I never hear nobody play the B section to that song. What's up, Mr. Fred Thomas? How are you, man?
I'm fine, Reggie, man. I'm doing good, thank God, you know.
Yeah, man.
I'm hanging in there, you know. And, as a matter of fact, you know, that was my first recording with Brown, you know.
Your first recording?
Yeah. That's my first recording with Hot Pants. Yeah.
What was that like, man? What's the story behind that? How did you even end up with the Godfather of Soul?
Oh, that's kind of a story. Actually, ever today, like I said, I had to go backtrack on, you know, like through the history of the other year that I was brown. And I went back and I found this British Press magazine. I think it was in the 90s. And they did like an interview with me and Sweet Charles Sorrell, and Boosie Collins. So they asked us all the same questions, you know. So they asked me, how did that hook up with Brown? Well, actually, what really happened was, okay. Oh, yeah, so I had a four-piece band, you know, just rhythm section, guitar, bass, drums, and one horn. And, you know, Wilk Chamberlain.
Yeah.
At the time, okay, Small Paris Island, you know, that was the cat, that was the place, you know that. Small Paradise, man, for all of that. And during my era, you know, that's what Lionel Richie, you know, that the Gap Band, you know, Cool in the Game. If she couldn't play, you didn't go to Small Paradise, right? So they booked my band in there, man. We had been playing that for a while. Anyway, James Brown was hanging out in Harlem, man. You know, him and this and Torres, you know, they was up hanging out, having a party and celebrating Sex Machine, da da da. So they popped in Smalls, and the people said, James Brown. I said, Mr. Brown, I said, you got to sing a song. Brown said, them cats don't know my song. They don't know my song. And then the audience said, oh, they know it. They know everything, you know. So, okay, all right, I'm going to do Sex Machine. Y'all know Sex Machine? I said, yes, yeah, we know Sex Machine. Come on. You know, and he come up, man, he come down, said, 1, 2, 3, 4, and we just kill it. We kill it. We actually murdered it. You know, I mean, with the hits, the hits in the end, we did all of that with clean as a whistle, just like that, you know. And he just, you know, he was too excited. But at that time, that's during the time when Boosie and them was on the wall pass, they was quitting. You know, he knew that. He needed a band anyway. And he told his management, man, he said, listen, hire the whole band. It wasn't but four of them, but hire them all. And that's how it started. You know, he hired the band, man.
And, y'all just killed it. That's why.
Yeah, we kill it, man. We did. I always said that we kill it, you know. I mean, like, really, you know, I had a very good band, you know,
In the day.
As a matter of fact, we just, you know, I had some original stuff, you know, material that was going to the studio and start recording. So everybody else, Lionel Richie, you know, and the Gap Band, all the people were Cool in the Game. Oh, you know, all the cats during that time, you know, was recording. They had new records, so we just want to record too. But Brown's, when they hired us, it's kind of like this, cut that out, you know what I mean? So,
okay.
And I went with Brown, man, you know, so like, I used to sing too, by the way, you know, I still sing, but I was singing with my band ever since I started my band in 66. And people said, Brown, Mr. Brown, you know, Fred Thomas can sing too, you know, Brown said, I know you can sing. I don't need a singer, I need a bass player. I'm a singer. That was the end of that, man. But that's some story behind that too, man. But I won't go into that. I'll let you go ahead, you know.
That's cool, man. I want to hear all that good stuff.
You know, the funny thing, Reggie, because, you know, like, really, man, James used to let me do a song, you know, every song. I know you're afraid I'm going to let you sing a song, you know, da 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 da. And one song I did was Back in Love Again, you know, Back in Love Again, son. I'll let you sing that song, Jeffrey Osborne, you know. I said, okay. And I sang it, man. I was killing it. You know, the band's playing. I'm playing bass. You know, they had two bass players. So I'm just singing the song. And after a while, the audience, you know, when the band get tight with you, you know, you start moving and the band is kicking, you know, his band. So, you know, the audience started, you know, standing up and all that stuff. After that, he put that playing on me. That's it. You are finished. Y'all might not sing another song, man, in another 6 months, you know.
You know what that meant, right? He didn't want to. Yeah. He didn't want to lose his band, y'all. You know?
No, he didn't want to use no clout, man. He wanted all of the clout.
Cause y'all would have left. Y'all would have got signed right there, man. And,
yeah, he put that sign on it. That's it. Yeah. That's it, man. You know, he didn't like that at all.
So you did live at Soul Power live at the Apollo Theater?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Revolution of the mind.
Soul Power! Soul Power!
What was it like, and that's appropriate, man, because that's what we're talking about right now. That, to me, that's the name of this edition, man. Black Soul Power, Black Soul Funk. Man, yeah. What was it like playing on those stages, those grooves, man? Like, who was on drums on that record?
Jabbo. John Starks.
John
Jabbo.
Jabbo?
Mm-hmm.
How long did he run with you guys?
Well, Jabbo was there when I got there, you know. And Jabbo was mainly his main drummer through the time that I was there. You know, through all the years. He had other drummers along with Jabbo, but Jabbo was the main event. Like most of the recording I did with Brown, man, you know, the albums, all of them, Jabbo played on most of that stuff. Clyde was there, you know, but he wasn't there, you know, consistently. Jabbo was there all the time, you know.
Okay. You know,
Jabbo had his own stuff. As a matter of fact, I did a consolation thing, Funky Drummers with Clyde and Jabbo, you know, with Fred Wesley and a couple more guys, man. You know, it's a drummer thing, you know. But I was the bass player when they was exercising and showing all the different, you know, drum parts and the different songs and the bass line. I played the bass line and stuff, you know.
Yeah, but I got a chance to check a little bit of that out.
Did you did?
Yeah, I saw a little bit of that. Yeah.
No, okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, can you put into words what that felt like? The energy between you and him grooving in like the different stages of, I know, nothing technical or nothing, man, just in your own words, like, what does that feel like when you in that kind of pocket, in that kind of zone?
Well, one thing I always said, like Flame of Brown, you know, like, a lot of guys say, well, you play, you know, what Brown tell you to play, what he wants you to play. But I always said it wasn't that, what Brown wanted you to play so much all the time. Sometimes what he give you to play is not necessarily what he really wants. You got to take that and make it your own.
Okay.
In order to make it feel good, you know. And so when I'm playing like on the live stage like that, especially on the live stage like that, you know, I'll be feeding off just the groove, man. You know, the groove and the Jabbo playing that one and that, you know, and he's a very precision drummer, you know, like holding the pocket, you know. And you know, when you hold that pocket, man, you know, it's right there. You know, you can flex, you know, you can flex and, you know, pull back, you know what I mean? And just flow, man, and then the energy, you know, the energy from the stage, man, is astounding, you know what I mean? Yeah, it was live, man. It's like when you go on stage, man, you come alive. I mean, like we played, like, you know, places in Europe, man, and festivals. As a matter of fact, I just looked at a video where we played Woodstock the last time. Man, I think they had 100,000 people out there, man. Just the energy of the crowd and then the energy of the players, man. And it brings about a chemistry change in you or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
How
important is that when it comes to, I mean, you know, you and I both know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it because some people just need to know. How important is it to get people dancing?
Listen, I said, if they ain't moving, you ain't grooving. You know, I mean, like, listen, people sit there and look at you. I tell my band all the time, I say, listen, you got to entertain these folks out here. You know, y'all can't be sleeping, you know what I mean? You got to give it to a man and make them move and make them feel good, you know? If you don't make them feel good, because I have played to audience, man, and, you know, you probably exercise that at one time or another. Some audience, man, they just sit there and look at you, you know, like, what are you doing? You know, maybe because it's not the flavor of music, they just happen to be there, you know what I mean?
Right.
And so they'll sit cold on you, you know what I mean?
They're trying,
man, you know, but eventually somehow you keep pumping at them, you get them up, you know what I mean? But it's very important, man, to see people moving. If they don't get out their seat, if you see them moving, man, you know, patting their feet or something, you know, then you know they're with the music. But if they ain't doing nothing, man, like, you know, hey, you know?
They gotta get up and get on that good foot, right?
Yeah, man. Bring it.
You gotta get on the good
foot. I say, I don't care which one it is. I say, you gotta get on the right foot, get on the left foot, you know? Just make it happen, man, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, come on. Yeah, absolutely.
Or they step on both of them. You know?
Yeah. You know what I mean? Here we go.
Where's all the people know what it's about?
from my pen. You know my face is getting short, I got the blues. I got a fucking job and I paid my dues on the good foot. Oh, on the good foot. I got to get on the good foot. Hey, on the good foot. Get on the good foot. Come on, hit it there. You got to get it. Get it. Shut it down. Come on, get it done.
Playing that live, if anybody with y'all playing that live can actually sit in their seat and act like that ain't moving them, I think people would hear that and be scared because they don't know what's happening to them inside their body. I'm like, real talk, like if you never heard funk, like back, you know, when, because that was a funk explosion, man, y'all were creating that. So
yeah.
That had to make people, like you said, some people probably just felt uncomfortable. Like, whoa, what's happening right now? Why does my body feel this way? It's not that they don't like it. They understand that revolution that they was being a part of, and they probably like, should I be enjoying this? Should I feel this?
Yeah.
You know, like, what's happening?
Yeah. Should I grab a hold of this and keep it alone? You know what I mean? Hey man, I'll tell you something, Richard. That's one of the particular songs, you know, recorded with Brown. And thing about recording with Brown gave you a line to play. He gave me that line to play. But the thing about it is, you have to find, to me personally, I have to find a way to groove a bass line within myself. I got to groove myself when I'm playing, like, you know, cause I read, a chicka boom, 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 a chicka boom, 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 a chicka boom, boom, boom. Cause we, after the downbeat, I'm like a chicka, you know what I mean? So I found that, you know, it kind of like felt like in a pocket with myself, and that's where I laid that line, you know what I mean? Where he get playing it straight up, doom, 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 doom. It, you know, he's got to put that perfect accent in the same place to make it flow with what's going on. Because, you know, everybody, think, you know. I mean, like, you know, you have to take what they give you, even though it's simple. You still got to make it groove. I don't care what kind of line it is, you know what I mean?
Right.
And that was the essence of with me trying to formulate bass lines with him, you know, and to make it happen and make it groove. A lot of bass players, hey, they play what they want to play, you know, and like boosting it, man. They play stuff the way they wanted to play it, you know. So the exact machine.
So you were more looking for the right placement, the right where the groove should really sit. You
know? Right. See, one thing about me, I'm just a bottom bass player. And I play patterns. Give me a pattern, I'll groove you forever. You know what I mean? There's nothing fancy, nothing excited about it, but I'm gonna collect that bottom in there and make it line groove, make it feel good. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's the way I kind of like flow. I also play with my thumb. Did you know that?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. You catch it. As you play all that with your thumb. I said, yeah, with my thumb. And my thumb so, you know,
Let me tell you something. I searched high and low to find some footage of you. I said, no way in the world he playing these bass lines with just one thumb. No way in the world. And you are.
Yeah, I mean, hey, you know the reason I play like that now? I did play with my fingers, you know, on sometimes. That's been time I played with my fingers.
Right.
You know, but the style came from when I first started learning how to play bass. You know, I always was a vocalist, you know, I was high school, even before I even knew what a bass was. You know, I was a singer, you know, and singing quartet in the country, you know, and in Georgia, you know, and, playing them little Duke Ducks, man. I didn't know what a bass was. Like a Fram on a guitar, a little bit, you know. But I didn't really know what a bass was, man, you know. So after I got to New York, that's when I like started learning how to play bass, man. And whatnot. But the thing about it is, I was singing. When I started playing bass, I already could sing. So I did all of the vocal. I did Otis Redding, Russell Pickett, Danny Brown, Tyrone Davis, you know, Sam and Dave. I did all of those cover tunes, you know, with my band. But I had to sing them. And it was more comfortable for me to play with the thumb, you know, and sing at the same time, you know, because funny thing about that, it takes a lot of practice too, man, because when the melody is going this way and the bass pattern is going that way and over here, and you got to be comfortable and sing the song right. You can't just be waiting on, like I do today, man. When Alpha Brown died, I'll tell you something. I had to start all over again, playing and singing.
Sure, really?
Yeah, because when I was playing with Brown, I played bass. And I told you he cut me off. He wouldn't let me sing, you know, but a little bit.
Right.
And then when I sang then, somebody else played bass. You know, so when he died, man, 2006, I said, oh, you know, I'm in the music. I got to go back and get me another band, you know, so that's what I did. But it took me for a while, man, to be able to, you know, fluently sing. You got to sing and you got to talk to the audience, you know, and joke with the audience. Meanwhile, you can't change the groove. The groove is going on, you know. You got to keep that groove rolling.
That's hard to do, man. It's really hard to do. And you know, I've been like, to even just talk in the mic, man, while you're trying to really, it takes so much time and attention.
It does.
It comes natural, yes, but it's, man, to really get them grooves that y'all laying on these records, man, you can't be fooling around having no conversations and unless you talking about how funky it is.
You know, we didn't get to that part of the conversation, but James Brown, we went around the world telling the big, all the audiences, man, all over the world, said Fred Thomas is the most simple bass player in the world. And I went to the we got a page, man, Wikipedia, you know, samples of my bass lines and stuff, you know, it's a lot, man. It's at the Google, which I didn't even really realize
right.
that it was, but it's a lot of samples. You know, the biggest sample of all that I really knew anything about was Lynn Collin. You better think. Dun, 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 dun. You take two to make things all right. That was the biggest sample, man. You know, like I said, wow, man. I'm still trying to collect, man.
Yeah, They don't understand.
Yeah, man. But
You need to get paid. You need to be getting paid for that.
Yeah, I really do, man. You know.
You know what I'm saying? We gotta tell them. You gotta tell them it's time for them to pay you back.
Yeah.
Pay back.
got to pay back. Revenge.
Pay Fred back.
Yeah, give me that some of that money, man.
I'm mad. Got to get back. I need some get back. Pay back. Pay back.
Atlanta.
You took my money. You got my honey. Don't want me to see what you're doing to me.
Gosh, bro. That's mean.
Hey, man, Brown was no joke, man. You know. Hey.
That was mean. So, you said Brown wasn't no joke, but he knew the right cats, man. He knew to get a band that wasn't no joke. Like that funk is so mean.
It's gonna lie.
I mean, even with that shaker, you know, the
where the percussionist.
Oh yeah.
Johnny Greer.
Okay.
Johnny Greer, yeah, he played percussion. He played all the tambourines and the kumos and the cabasso. He played all those trees and stuff. You know what I said too, though, Wretched, and you know, like this is in like my teaching also. You know, like I've been saying about Brown, but Danny Brown front, is that James knows what type of song to come up with, mm-hmm. according to what kind of delivery he could get from the musicians that he had. He kind of like knows the musicians. He found out about his musicians. And what their strongest point is, and then he gel them all together, and he come up with a song. Sometimes, man, he used to just write, scribble on a brown paper bag, you know. And so we go in the studio to record. Meanwhile, he get the studio, he got some stuff here and scribble on a brown paper bag, you know. And we go in the studio to record an idea, you know. But just the musician, like you say, he got a selection of musicians, man. Cats, man, that just know how to get down, and they bring their heart and soul and put it all in there. Well, however good a player you are, they might not be the greatest player, you know, but, you know, whatever they play, man, they give it their all and all. I think that's what really made all his, made all the strongest punch in his music, you know, his recording.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree 100% more, man. I mean, the chemistry was real. It was insane. Let me ask you this, you know, in dealing with, say, that time and that era, when y'all you would go in the different cities, different parts of the world, let alone different cities, y'all were all around the world. Did you have to deal with a lot of racism?
Wow. Never did. I don't know. It's when I really look back and think about it, there was never a point of really racism or nothing too much. When I joined Brown, I don't know. Now, I think before that, before, back in the early days, like the early 60s. When I was still in school and carrying on, Brown was out there, playing the real chitlin circuit. That's when everybody had a gun. At that time. But now, when I joined Brown, he always had, white people in his group. In the band as well as the background, some of the dancers.
Yeah. He was a little, his background singers, he's a little integrated with his performance, I've noticed. But y'all never had any problems, maybe like at certain venues where you might have, anything that you can recall where they treated you a certain way, or anything like that? No, that's beautiful, man.
Yeah, it's really like amazing. Now that I never really thought about it until you just mentioned it.
Yeah.
But when I really think back through the years, man.
And then you see how powerful I contribute that to James Brown, Godfather, to you, to the rest of the band. The music that y'all sent off to the people to hear into their hearts and into their souls, it was contagious, and it just went viral worldwide to where everybody just wanted some of what you had. So they didn't come to see you. If they didn't like you, they were just gonna stay home. So whoever came to hear James sing or perform is because they felt that energy through these records, the way we feeling them even right now, that y'all were given, and they wanted to come and hear that. They might have went back home and been racist again, black or white, whatever color they were. They might have went back home to be a jerk, but when they came to see y'all play, everybody left that at the door and came in together under that one sound and under that one groove.
Right.
Because that's right, that you would say you've never experienced that in all them years, in those early years, traveling as a band anyway. They were showing y'all all kind of love, which is amazing.
And it's amazing, now that I think back through it, there wasn't even a time, maybe you had to stay in certain hotels or stuff like that. I can't recall no racial issue, even with that, and with the traveling on the bus and all of that stuff, flying or nothing like that. It always was pretty cool, man. Of course, I don't remember, I would remember if there was, but I can't recall a time that really happened, it's funny thing about that, because, like I said, James had, white guys in his band, for long periods of time. I mean, during the time that I was there, we might not have had known too much before me, but I could say that, like, after the JB's, JB's era was from, 71 to 76, the JB's. All of the recording was done. That's when I did all my recording with Brown. Through those years, from 71 to 76. But I did all of my recording with Brown, you know, and I got, I think about 5 albums for Brown and a couple of albums for Lynn Collin and an album or two with Bobby Bird. And the JVs have 5 albums, you know, some of them compilation albums, but we got 4 albums, man. We got 5 albums, mm-hmm. 5 albums, you know. And really, I did happen to do 85 a set based on all those albums, man. You know, I just named, you know, really. So I did a lot of music. I said, man, why don't y'all play something? We recorded so much stuff, rather. We didn't never play none of it. you know, I mean, like, you know, JB's, I'm talking about, you know. We didn't play none of that stuff, man. You know, we played a couple of songs, like, Give Us Some More, Parrot the Pig, Gonna Have a Funky Good Time, Watergate, and it's a lot of music. You know, you might have what music on 4 or 5 albums, man. And we played 3 or 4, 5, 6, 7 tunes out of the whole JV set. Because, you know why? Because the show was for Brown. It wasn't for the band. So when we went to play, we did an opening song. That's it. Opening song, maybe 2 here and there, you know, but that's basically it. Yeah.
Wow. And I mean, mentioning, I remember the first time I heard Funky Good Time. Let's give a listen to that.
Oh, how you feel, brother?
Feeling good.
You feel good? Play so much bone, brother. How you feel, man?
I feel all right.
I call your name. I don't want people to know you're in here. How you feel, brother? Hey, jam. Yeah. Sure getting down. Look at him. Ah. We're gonna have a funk. Wave y'all in, you know what? I feel so down. I need to get down.
In order for me to get down, I got to get in deep. In order for me to get down, I got to get in deep. Need to get in deep. Dog the D. Down D. Funky D. Shaking D. Down D. Oh!
Oh! Yes, oh, you know. Yeah, man.
Get on down. Morgan Lamp, you like me? That make him think about making a big M. Look here. Yeah. Look at that. Is you over there? We better sing one verse for us. What we gotta do? Gotta have a funk good time. Oh yeah. Gotta have a funk good time. Oh yeah. Gotta have a funk good time. I didn't know you were singing, Fred. Don't moan so much, brother. Don't moan so much.
Like that no more.
I don't know, man. I want to tell you a little story behind that song.
Please tell it.
James Brown, it's just a shuffle, you know. And James Brown gave me the line to play. I said, well, that ain't enough. And I put the hump in it. Yeah, I just took his line and, you know, and put that little triplet in there. Yeah. Yeah. And that made it change the whole song, man. You know, so, hey.
Woo!
You don't have no whole song written out. You know, you make up this stuff kind of like when you get in the studio, a lot of it.
I was going to say that. It sounded like he was very, he's very spontaneous, you know. So, he start with an idea and then just let the groove take over.
Right. You know, you really said it all. I mean, the groove happened going, he just, stuff that's come to him, you know. Because if you don't remember, believe me, all that stuff that he said, he did not write that down. No, he did not write all that stuff down, Jack. You know, no way. You get the idea, just like you said.
Yeah.
And then the groove, you get caught up in the groove, and he might see anything, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So amazing, man. And what bass were you playing? Was that a Fender Precision, Fender Jazz, or not a Fender at all?
No, I played, that was a Fender Precision. The P bass was my bass, you know. She wouldn't believe what I first started with. But anyway, the P bass.
What did you start with? Go ahead, man.
Yeah, you listen, you probably have never heard of it. Listen, the bass called, it was called a Zimga bass. That was like in 66, man. I mean, it had a bow in the neck like this here, you know. I mean, the string was like this, you know, with the bow. That was like my first bass, man. It was incredible. And the first amp I had, what they call a Magatone.
Mm.
You know what I mean? You remember that. Yeah, but the Magatone out, man, you know, the Zim God bass. Every time I hit a note, the amp ran out. It was amazing. And then I managed, man, and I got me a Fender, man. Me a Fender bass, man. And, the whole thing just turned around after that, you know. I had a lot of stories with the Fender bass, man. I cussed them out. I did all kinds of stuff with them. Quick story. I bought a Fender bass, and it was like in the 90s, too. Yeah. I bought a Fender bass. And brand new bass, man. Every time I went on the road, man, it would stay in tune, you know, the intonation, everything just go off, you know. And so I said, well, I take it back. I did that, had it set up about 2-3 times, man, you know. Then when I come home, you know, then I go back. And so I took it back to the store. I said, yo, man, you have to give me another neck, you know. This neck was not going to hold the tune. It's keep bowing up. You know, no, well, we can't get you another neck. You know, we can sell you another bass guitar. And music store out in Coney Island. Yeah. So the guy would not give me another bass. I mean, and he would not give me another neck. He put on the bass. I said, man, this is a brand new bass. I haven't had it less than like 6 months, you know. Anyway, long story short, so he wouldn't give me a neck. So I called the company, the Fender company, and told them about it, you know. And they wouldn't give me a bass either.
Wow.
You know, and they wouldn't get me a neck, you know. I said, this you made this, man. There ain't nothing I did to it. You know, I play bass, and that's what I do. So I took the bass, brand new bass, I took it back to the store. I cussed them out in the store, cussed from the company out. I cussed them out in the store and told them, y'all had this piece of whatever, you know, you keep it, you know, and a bunch of names, you know. Mm-hmm. I was really fired up, of course. Mm-hmm. You know, and I just left it in the store. It's yours, you know. I never did go back, you know, about it. But after that, man, I played some old basses, you know, and, through the years, you know, but that's my favorite bass, man. Right to this day, right now, I don't even have a Fender bass, you know. I have other basses. You know, I have two five string basses. You talk about the bass. I have two five string basses, and three four string basses. You know, the five string basses, I bought them. You know, I'm not really a big fan of the five string bass. But I bought it simply because, you know, I was telling you about that I played a lot of gospel music through the years.
Right.
So whenever we went into the church, you don't need programs to play. If they got a big hammer sitting up there and you playing a four string, man, you can get kind of lost in the mix. If you're coming on after the hammer organ finished playing that boom, 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 and you come up with your little, unless you got a whole lot of amplification, you know, yeah. Your four string ain't gonna get there, man. So I bought it, I used it a lot then when I was playing church a lot, because the B string was the competition. You know what I mean? That was my competition with that Hammond, man, you know. Because otherwise, man, them cats eat you alive. You sound like you ain't even playing. You know,
it's still a few cats in church that's killing the four strings, man. You know, but they do have a drop key in where they can detune that E string down like to a C. You know.
Yeah, I had one too, man. I used to tune it down to the D.
So on most of those records, what bass were you using?
They were Fender, all Fender. I never used nothing but Fender basses on those records.
Man, I'm sorry that happened to you, man. I'm not a representative of Fender at all. I don't own any Fender basses. My brother had a Fender bass, a Fender Mustang, and I learned on that bass. It was a short scale four string.
Yeah.
But after that, when I got hip to like Stanley Clark and a bunch of other cats, after that I switched to Olympic and then Ken Smith and then Federa, who I'm with now, and I've never owned a Fender bass and never went out and bought a Fender bass. And now I don't want to because of what I'm hearing they did to you. They need to put out the Fred Thomas line of Fender basses.
Thanks, brother.
That's what needs to happen. I mean, real talk.
You know, and that's what really, excuse this, really pissed me off, because here's a Fender company, man. I said, listen, man, I've been representing you guys, man, since I played with Brown and traveling, you know, and all this music I recorded, it was a Fender bass, You know, so like you said, you don't own one. I don't either. I told you, I don't own one either. And I'm not going to buy another one, you know, after that, you know, because that's ridiculous, man.
It was ridiculous. I agree. 100%. 100%. I want to play another tune. We're going to see what we could do about that. I want to play another tune, though, with the JPs. The Pass the Peas.
Yeah.
I used to hate peas when I was little. And I used to hate peas. And I had a good friend of mine I grew up with. We were best friends. We were like brothers. We lived across the street from each other. He wasn't a musician. He was as good in sports as I was in music. And we would. But I was forced to be a pretty decent athlete myself. He went to college to play sports and all of that, and I always had to play against him and with him anyway. That was one of the things, man. It was like, oh man, I'm gonna go inside. You know, my mom and my dad, you know, they calling me. It's time to go eat. And now he's not musical at all. But I mean, he not as far as playing, but music is all. And he would start going, like, I might have the football in my hand, and we're starting to part because he got to go eat dinner. We might be like 14, 15, or 12. And he going, pass the peas, pass the peas. And come to find out, one day I went, we were always at each other's house, but one day I'm in the basement and I'm going through all these albums, you know, Sister Sledge and what's his name? Rick James and James Brown and then he started playing that. I said, man, you always saying pass the peas. What's with peas? I hate peas. You know, we just being kids like little rascals or something.
Right, like, right.
Never heard that song. So his aunt used to play and his uncle, they used to play all them records. So he played the record for me one day and I was like, oh, okay. You know.
That's what you talk about.
You said you got a chance to meet some gospel artists. When you used to travel and play out. And who were some of those people that you got a chance to hear?
The Mighty Clouds of Joy, man. I worked with them guys. And the Five Blind Boys, man. You know, them cats was the funny, man. I loved working with them guys. I was just glad to be on the program, man, with these guys, man. Especially the Five Blind Boys, man. You can swear them guys could see, man. You know what I mean? The cats would run up the aisle, man, and you know, like you know where you're going. So, you know, and,
well, you know, rumor has it that it was all of them might not have been blind. It was kind of a hack.
So somebody acting blind.
I was peekabooing.
You know, yeah, man. But anyway, man, like a lot of them, man, you know, the Soul Stirrers and
yeah,
you know, all them guys, man, old school quartets, and a lot of them, man. I really was enjoying playing gospel, man, a lot, you know, because during the time when I quit Brown and 76, the first time I quit. But and after I quit Brown in 84, I quit Brown.
Right.
You know, the second time I quit. And that's when I played from there until 92, man. I still had a little band, but I played a lot of gospel, man. You know, like I traveled with this group, you know, played around town with my wife's group, you know. They got a couple of CDs, you know.
Okay. And, what's the name of those CDs, man?
Evangelist Blue and Spiritual Love. Evangelist Blue. See, yes, he's an evangelist here. Yeah. Evangelist Blue and Spiritual Love. That's the group my wife sang with, when I, you know. But the other group that I play with, her name, she got two CDs also with Daptone Label. And her name is Naomi Shelton and the Gospel Queens. You know, she's got no other gospel artist, man. You know, she got a very deep voice, and she's very soulful, very soulful. And she's unique. She's unique, man. You know, she's not a screamer. You know, she just straight up. I don't even know how to describe her, man. You know, maybe see if we communicate, man. I'll try to get something over to you, so you can just listen to her, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, just check her out, man, and hear what she did. She did songs like Cold War. But a big hit would put out there was What Have You Done, My Brother? What Have You Done, My Brother? Yeah.
Okay. When was that out? When was that released?
That was released about 6-7 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's all good, man. But I'm still moving, man, moving and grooving. And the thing about it, Reza, you know, I'm feeling good. Just had a birthday, man. So, you know, I'm still feeling good.
I know, man.
You know, man.
Just a few days ago, right?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're a man of much wisdom, and you've seen a lot of things, but you've been blessed to travel the world and see a lot of people, see a lot of different things. How do you feel about what's going on now?
When this started, when the lockdown came, I was in my basement and it hit me, or something hit me. And I turned my cell phone on and I started recording about the coronavirus. Then I started recording about the condition that the world is in and what the world is going through now. And I talked about that. And then after a couple of tapes of that, then I started writing like spiritually writing, and I've been doing this since the beginning. I have a lot of literature on it. You know, just in the morning, I get up like before breakfast, and some come over me, and I just start writing on my phone, you know, my notes. I just keep going. I keep going. I refuse to be disturbed, okay? So ain't nothing over with until God says over with.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And God is the only one. Man cannot work miracles. He can build stuff and do whatnot, but God is the only one that can work miracles in your life. I said, when you look at the coronavirus, you know, you think about the fact that there are peoples, God, we are all God people, but there are peoples that goes in and they recover from the virus, but everybody don't recover from the virus.
That's right.
So God saw fit to save who he saved. You know what I mean? But at the same time, God looking down, I said, he's looking down right now, just saying, I wonder, are they going to learn anything from this? You know, hey man, I wrote a lot, so I can just go on. I got pages. Then I got to the black, to Black Lives Matters, you know. And I went down through the criminal justice system. I talk about it, where it started at. It started at the top, and it infiltrates all the way down through the justice department, down to the police, and who's supposed to protect. Da, 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 da. Then I even talked about it. I said, the thing about it is, the criminal justice system hires the police, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I said, do they screen these people? Do they screen them to check out their background? What they did, where they from, you know, what kind of family, what kind of school they went to? Did they go to a segregated school? Or, you know what I mean? I mean stuff like this. I talk about stuff like that, man. And a lot of stuff, man, you know. But it's all comply with what's going on.
Yeah, it is.
They say, why don't you paste it, man? Post it. I said, no, I ain't post nothing yet, you know.
Turn it into a song, a funky song.
Hey, and I'll tell you something now. I told a few people, I said, I'm writing at the same time I'm on my computer, I'm doing some music. I said, I want to get a good, now this is the truth, I'm working on this now. I want to get a good, because I got a lot of writing, I can pick and choose to really concern stuff. And I wanted to make a theme. You know, I had started making like a little background pad, you know, with orchestrated type music, man, that would sound like with a voice. And I want like, you know, like background singers, man. But when they sang like, you know, like back in the old days.
Yeah.
Type that, you know, like us moaning, you know, when we coming out. Mm-hmm. And I thought about it in a sense, I even thinking about, you know, like a person that can rap or a certain part of it, you know, then that would be, you know, I'm working on it, trying to fix this and put it all together with what I'm writing. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, man, maybe I can just kind of like pass some of it over to you and, you know, you can see what I'm trying to do. And hey, man, and just not me, hey, that's hey. Not you.
Pass the peas, man.
Hey, bro, you said it, you know.
Pass the peas.
Yeah, man.
Yes, sir. Pass the
peas. Yeah, bro, for real. Yeah.
You played on Make It Funky.
Yeah. Make It Funky? Yeah, I believe it.
Yeah.
Now, everybody in the group, we from down home, you understand? We don't mind talking about it because it's a group. Crowd. Come up here and take your business and go on back down and enjoy ourselves, you understand? Yeah. Yeah, but I never would know where the man coming from. Up here, he's jiving you. You understand? We can deal with him when we see him. Ha! Look at him! I better check out some of his cats here. We got one cat in the group, you know. Like I said, we like to talk about where we're from. We got one cat in the group, Jason. He says he's from Ohio. Yes, he says he's from Ohio. I don't know such place name as Ohio, so I know where Ohio is. So you know he's from down there because he don't even know how to say it. Right, Trees? Give him a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. He's beautiful, though. I got to apologize. I don't want to gang up on him when I get out there. I might have to bring some of New York out there. Wait a minute.
Say, Jeff, where you from? Mobile, Jeff, give him a big round of applause. Mobile. Say, Morgan, brother.
Hell yeah.
I got to get all these drummers, because if you don't get all the drummers, they might pick it in front of you, though. I can't stand none of that. Say, brother, where you from?
Georgia.
Say it again.
Georgia.
Now, don't try to identify with the whole state of Georgia. Where you from, brother?
Macon, Georgia.
Macon, Georgia. Give him a big round of applause. Macon, Georgia. Brother Otis Randon and Real Richard and people like that. Yeah. Uh-huh. Say cheese. Sure got a funky guitar, don't he?
Yeah.
Funky is a wannabe.
Yes, yes.
I hope people don't get me confused when I say, he sure got a mother there. When we say mother, we mean he bad, you understand? I don't know where you coming from. But look, I'm sure glad you're a soul brother, because that's a country stroke you got. A cornbread lick, you dig it? Put a little hoe cakes on the side and that. Now, most of y'all don't know what hoe cakes is. A hoe cakes is when you get the bread and lay it out there and roll it like you please. Make it funky. Make it funky. Say cheese. You know, like I said, if you wasn't a brother, you could get accused real quick. I might be false accusing, but I see you saying, I'll be coming around the mountain. I know that's not him, you understand? Yeah. You sure got a peculiar lick there, brother. Say, brother, I don't want to get into your personal affairs and things, but I would like to ask you something. And by the way, we're recording now, you understand? This is live at the part of volume 3. Volume 3, so holler loud and, you understand, say I'm in it. Let yourself be heard. So say it one more time, brother, look here. Now you tell me, where you was born and raised?
Lake Range.
Where, brother?
Lake Range.
Lake Range. Lake Range, where, brother?
Lake Range, North Carolina.
Yeah! Lake Range, North Carolina! Yeah! Take another bow, brother! Another bow, Lake Range, North Carolina! Don't be so mean! But, brother, the next time, would you kindly be careful and don't lay so deep in your grange? Okay? Brother Martin, give him another big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah!
Yeah, cheesy.
Backstage deep. Laughing. When I said lay in your grave, I didn't say graves in the grass. I said lay in your grave. Funny cats, man. Say, Fred, this is our music and band director. Sure got a strange horn there, brother. I like it, though. Black horn. What's the significance behind it, Jack?
Black and proud.
Right on. Right on.
Black and proud.
What you say? Back to the biz on. Boom. Let's say one thing, brother. If you got a name for it, because I know B.B. King named the guitar Lucille, put your name in your horn.
I call it the Soul Sister.
Only thing I got to disagree with you on, mine look different than hot pants, baby. Yeah. But I know it's together. Look in here, because I want everybody to feel funky. Now, let me tell you something. You're going to get Sex Machine. All the shows coming. You're going to get Sex Machine. And if that don't do it, you're going to give it some more sex.
Yeah.
And if you don't get... enough then, and we'll see you later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's what you're doing. You don't get enough. See you later.
Yeah.
That's right. That's what you're doing. Yeah. See you later. Look. Look at him. Yeah, there's a whole lot of things you got to see later. I don't know how late, but you see it. And we're gonna give you a super bad, get involved, soul power. Well, if your pants ain't hot, we're going to make them hot before you leave, so don't worry about that. We're going to try to make them hot. Now, brother, since everybody's in the groove, the funk is feeling good, we want to keep them kind of clapping the hands, stomping the feet and things. Look at him. Strike out the horn and get down a little bit. Make sure you get down. It's all right. Right about now, hit me. Get it. Bread.
Beach Street. Brother Steak. Rudabag. Crowd of people. Lime for beef. Sure enough, lad. There's one thing I'd like to ask you. Knowing you're a college graduate, you finished college?
Yeah.
All right, brother. You finished college?
Yeah.
Don't be so polite, because you can get cut up there like that. Come on down home with me, you understand? You good for me. But don't get sassy. Look here. Look here. Something else I'd like to say, too. Can we pride in Western Affair? Because like everybody here, we're home, we're in the same family. We want to know about each other. You know, this is the thing that we should have been doing a long time ago, knowing about each other, so we can share the same problem and the same dream. But we got to make it a reality and quit dreaming. Look here. Can you tell me where you was born and raised?
L.A.
Now, wait a minute. You can't condemn a man. Let's listen to the case. Well, let's hear the case. Your brother's been being railroaded all their life. You don't just in case, you understand? That's what's wrong now.
Exactly.
Just make sure we get a case.
Yeah.
You know? Where you from, brother?
L.A.
On second thought, you may be right about this cat, but I think I'll rephrase the thing, because I don't think he heard me. You know? Brother, what we're saying is, we know you've been to L.A. We know that. We know you probably went out there on a Greyhound and come back on a stray dog. We're aware of that. But we'd like to know one thing. Oh, I think Brother St. Greg got it. That's it, brother. Look at him. He say you're going to hide behind a sheet and thing on him, but he say hide behind a sheet and make me think about Alabama.
That is brutal.
Yeah, look at him. We don't like sheets up here.
No, we don't.
Anything, pillowcase, but the sheet got to go. Sweaty. Yeah, right on with Uncle Tom and all of us. Look at him. Now, like we said, we know you've been out there. Got yourself together. But we're talking about where you started from, where you went to, before you went to L.A.
L.A., that's for Lower Alabama.
Ah! Brad Weston, ladies and gentlemen.